Welcome to Modern Farm Business Podcast. This podcast is designed to help the farm leader bring their business to the next level. We'll cover everything from leadership and finance to strategy and planning. I'm your host, Dean Hefta. Joining me today from her farm in Eastern Iowa is speaker, writer, and consultant Jolene Brown. She's a true champion for agriculture and is on a mission to bring best practices, appreciation, and celebration to the people who feed, clothe, and fuel the world. Jolene, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Dean. I could hardly wait for this conversation.
Yes, it's great to reconnect. We've known each other for years now and shared the stage. And you've been at hundreds of kitchen tables. And when we talk about family business, neither families nor business is simple by themselves, but you put them together and you can have some real challenges. When you think about family business, what goes through your mind?
Well, this is true, Dean. There's nothing better or worse than working with family members. But, you know, all of these years of working with them, they have taught me something. And that is, if you want to love and honor your family and sit together at the holiday table, you got to do the business right. Because if not, they end up with neither family nor business.
That's a great point. And there's a lot of tension that can come up because we get to work together all day. And then we get to see each other at the birthday party and Thanksgiving and Christmas. And those can be blessings and those can be really big challenges that other businesses and other people don't have to deal with. And, you know, with all of those potential pitfalls, it's really great to see how many operations that really are functioning at such a high level and doing so well. Here's a couple of questions in one. I guess one is, it's easy for us to drive by an operation and say, oh man, they've got it all figured out. First question is, how many of those operations that we think have it all figured out do? And then of the ones that you see are really doing well, are there some commonalities that they share with others that are doing well? What can we learn from that?
Oh, wow. Good questions. So you asked, do they really have it figured out? And what I know is I don't hear from those folks because they're doing so many things well that they want to make it even better. So when I see those people, it is a lot of workshops, a lot of meetings such as those which Water Street hosts that we bring together to fine-tune the things that we do, to make sure that we haven't dropped the ball on something that could really bring us down. And yes, there are so many people in agriculture who are family-based. It can be up to 97% of all people in ag production. And many of them are doing things right, and yet they want to keep on learning. So as far as how many, who knows? Because behind closed doors or what happens, I'm not sure. But the one thing I do always hear is, Jolene, you've been sleeping under my bed. So I tell them it was highly entertaining. And at the same time, there's always those things that are brought to the surface that we have to work on. So I really have spent some time the last 4 years studying what successful family businesses have in common. And I found there's two parts to that answer. The first is they do specific things. In other words, they put specific things in writing, such as they have a managing people chart so they know whose jobs are what. They have a business overview with a business plan. You're going to find they know how to deal with conflict at the mosquito bite level, which we often forget. They also have a code of conduct because we have different generations coming in with different standards. But really, they also take a very hard look at the money because money truly matters. And they have to understand that in family business, we're dealing with cash flow, not just the net worth. So as far as putting the things in place, there are specific tools that they use, and they use monthly, they use for their annual reviews, and then they make sure they have a good advisory team. They know the need to have a really strong attorney, an accountant, a family business coach, and personally they need a financial planner. So that was a lot of tools they have in place. But here's what I found. I found that they have really focused on three behaviors. And as I interviewed these people, and then I've had the chance to work with them on their advisory councils, here's some things I feel, that they certainly all notice more. They're paying attention to the details, not just what works and what doesn't, but they pay attention to the details of the people in the business. They use encouragement and praise for all generations and for all positions. They notice more. Second, I found they give more than they have to. I can't tell you the number of times I've had to grin when I hear them say to each other, how can I help you do your job better? You see, they're thinking us and not just me. And then they always are growing in their ability to deliver more value because they've learned that school is never out. And when they attend to their education and their experience, they have increased possibilities, which increases productivity and profitability, and they seek those resources to increase the value of their goals. So they do both specific things. They have things in writing, they have things legal, it makes money sense, and then they also have a check on their behaviors.
Boy, those are some key things that are, I would say, easy for us to not do. You know, every farm has a system, but not every farm makes the leap into being able to write down and describe, this is how we do things here, and this is who does what. And that seems like that place where kind of that magic happens, that leap happens. Would you say that's right?
Well, yes, we are superior at production. We are so good at weeds and seeds, breeds and feeds, money, machinery, and marketing, but we're crappy with people. And yet it's the people who do all the production. So if I have a family business that knows we've got a lot of work to do, but let's spend a little bit of time here making sure that we're doing the people business right, then the production flows so much easier with more productivity and profitability. So you are right, Dean. And you know what? I'm just like the people because I'm a real Farmer Brown. The more I have to work with people, the more I like pigs. If I don't like that old biddy, I'm going to send her to market. Can't do that with my cousins or moms or dads or aunts or uncles. So once we realize we're in the people business, it requires a different mindset. Not equal time spent on all of this, but the time you do spend on it will certainly increase your outcome at the other end of production as well.
Now, Jolene, when you think about the people business, it's more than just the family that's working alongside me or my employees on the farm. Do you see that really on the successful farms expanding out into a lot of their suppliers and customers and community? Like that competency for people, it's really expansive, isn't it?
It sure can be. And boy, don't we need that in agriculture right now for advocacy, for leadership, for management skills, and then bringing that back to the business. When you do the business right, that's how you honor the family. And what I see is that those who are successfully managing and leading their business, and this isn't just one person because you don't just lead and manage from the top down. You've got to have it from the bottom up, supporting that type of mindset as well. Then we have a chance to make a legacy in agriculture.
So farming can feel a little bit like it happens, for lack of a better term, in a silo. I'm out here getting the job done, doing my thing, making sure we're meeting the bottom line and getting the bills paid. But in growing my skills with people, what are some ways that I could maybe hone some of those abilities or bring some new insights to the table to grow my ability? Because maybe since I was 17, I've just been focused on the farm, but I recognize my farm's growing. The need for people skills is increasing. What are some ways that I could build some of those skills?
Well, I think it's really important if you're another generation coming in that you have worked for someone else before you work for a family member at least 2, preferably 3 years. And this does not count internship. So what really tickles me is when I meet a young man and I said, so how long have you been farming? And he'll say, I've been farming since I was 4 years old. I was always riding along with mom and dad. And I say, oh, no, you were learning about farming. I want to know how long have you been farming. So it's that experience and education you have first away from your family business allows you to bring so much more into the business, plus your confidence and your role on the farm of, as far as being perspective of entitlement is gone, because we really have to work on that issue. So one of the resources is you work for somebody else. Then please don't underestimate peer groups or masterminds. And what I find is we don't want to... You know, people in agriculture don't want to talk to their neighbors. We're in competition with them. Heaven forbid we want the same land to rent. But as you are at these events, you're going to find people from other states. And I have so many peer groups that are starting that, for example, the last Thursday night of each month, they've agreed to be on a phone call. And the whole agenda of that phone call is something good that's happened since the last time we talked, a realistic concern or problem we're working on, we need some help with. And what is the dream or goal I have for the future? So we're elevating how we lead, how we manage our understanding, and getting perspective outside of our own little silo, as you mentioned. Certainly, I appreciate those who show up at my workshops and use some of the resources that I have to increase their family business. And Water Street has them as well. So what I know is that the education experience of opportunities abound. But we will know that we'll spend more time learning about production than we do about people. So we have to have some balance in our skills and understand that the management and leadership skills are sorely needed. Some of them are innate. Most of them are not, because we're fiercely independent in agriculture. And we carry that mindset, and that we are going to work with people independently, not interdependently.
Right on. Now, when we deal with farming, you know, it's hard not to talk about the generational aspect that comes into farming. And as there's a new generation, you know, working into a farm, there's usually some of the siblings that aren't coming into the business. What do you bring to the table when you think about the concept of fairness and equality and all of that that you deal with the next generation?
Well, the beginning is here. There is no entitlement to be in a business. I'm often asking the senior generation, as they're considering bringing a family member in, would you post this position for just anyone to apply, or only you making a position so a family member can come back and be here? Because if we're going to treat this as a business, we must have a worthy job and then a worthy candidate. This means you will be invited to join a family business once the qualifications are met. And you've heard me speak long enough to know that I have very specific qualifications before you invite a family member in. So there's no entitlement here. And then there are different ways to equitably get people started, but I always have to ask each generation, are you willing to build up your personal equity in a business? In other words, are mom and dad willing to co-sign a note so I, as the next generation, might go out and buy land in my own name and then have in writing the exchange of my labor on their land for use of their equipment on my land? It doesn't always have to be in the current 1,000 acres that we have we're buying into. We can build equity in that way. And if we're going to have them join an existing business and build equity, then for heaven's sake, you got to have structures that allow that incrementally to happen. And Dean, you and I know we have got to keep operations. These are movable things, crops and critters and machinery and people in one structure. And then we must have land in another structure. So we're always making ways that they can be tied together. And then above all, be really upfront. You have to have a buy-sell agreement so that terms can be met to no matter whom this is left to. If you want the integrity to the business to continue, it has to be tied together. And so it's really important that we don't have entitlement, that we have skin in the game, that we have a commitment to help them build personal equity, either in our business and or in another business, and tie them together. And when you do that, you have helped them. Now, also keep in mind that maybe you've helped your other children along the way. I have had many farmers say to me, well, I help my kids that aren't farming. I help them buy their house, or I paid for their education, or we bought their new car, or we financed something for them. Well, just as you are starting them, you may be starting the equity of those in agriculture along the way. So make sure that you have this in writing, that things are clarified. And one of the questions I had last week, Dean, was from a mom and dad who said, do we have to tell the kids? Do they have to know what we're going to do? I said, yes, because if the assets of your estate affect the continuation of the business, then the rules of the game must be known. And once they hear this from mom and dad, not at the reading of the will, we have a much better chance for a successful transition.
Well, Jolene, isn't it just enough for me to say to the next generation, hey, someday this is all going to be yours?
Well, that's a lie. You know, they may mean it, but if you don't do the work behind it, it's just a conversation. That's right up there with, you know, I'm going to retire, and don't worry about your brothers and sisters. They have their jobs. They're not interested in the business. Those are all wonderful conversations, but they mean absolutely nothing unless we've done the work to make it happen.
Great point. Let's take on a couple of roles here. Let's say I'm mom or dad, and I'm really having a hard time turning some of these decisions over to the next generation. What should I have in my mind as I think about this transition of roles and responsibilities?
Well, I'm real clear when I work with those who own the assets, and quite often that is the senior generation. I ask them a very specific question, and that is, do you really want the integrity of this business to continue beyond your lifetime? And I need a yes or a no, or a we'll see, but we don't know how. I don't want any of that. I just want, is this the fire in your belly that you want the integrity of this business to continue beyond your lifetime? And if they say yes, then there's two things we've got to do. We must make sure that they're financially secure and that they're emotionally ready. You know, I have learned that if the senior generation is financially secure, if they have not secured the lifestyle, the living, and the health care that they deserve, they will never relinquish control because they don't want somebody to dink around with their security. And they manage the next generation to death. So one of the key things here is you better have a personal financial planner working with that senior generation so they can feel secure. And if they have not, if they don't have income outside of the farm to keep them going, they have to keep some assets in their own name in liquid because they might need it for their lifestyle and living. They have got to be financially secure first and then emotionally ready. You know, we've all heard, I was born in this farm, I'm going to die in this farm. I'm going to dive my boots on. Well, we all want that. And for heaven's sakes, don't kick a farmer or rancher off the farm or ranch because you're going to kill their soul. But if they have said that they want the business to continue beyond their life, beyond their living, then what they have said, we're going to be the heart of a teacher. And the number one, my number one job is to replace myself. Now, when it comes to decision making, again, with the managing people chart, we see how this is incrementally done. And when the next generation has heard, oh, now you're going to be in charge of, for example, agronomy, or you're going to be in charge of marketing, and wouldn't you know, here comes the senior generation taking it over. You have to say to them, oh, mom and dad, I thought you gave me this responsibility. Do you want it back? Because if you want it back, it can be yours. But I'd really like to learn. Obviously, I'm not doing something that you think should be considered. Please be my teacher. And when you have that kind of approach, you are honoring their grit, their wisdom, their years on the farm, and that will help you become a much better student as well.
Now, what if I'm in the up-and-comer role? You know, I'm the next generation, and I feel like my parents are just looking at me like I'm a hired hand. What can I do?
Well, first of all, are you doing more than a hired hand? Take a look at what you're currently doing. And are you adding value beyond this? Are you able to help solve their problems? You know, have you figured out what they need? Because you see, the value of what we do is in the eye of those who are providing to us, not those of us who are doing the work. And so we have to understand where we come from. We ask them their biggest concerns, their biggest problems. And sometimes you have been around long enough, you know what they are. You find ways to solve those problems. Make sure that you have an opportunity, if you're the up-and-comer, to earn and purchase equity, especially when you are married. This need to have financial security in your own name is really, really key as we come along. So when you ask, when they say, well, I'm just a hired hand, well, who's defining that? Is it you by your behaviors in your work, or is it by those not giving you a chance to do more than labor? You have to give more than value, but you were hired. One of my prerequisites is because you're going to bring something. So that's where you start asking for some management decision-making time to actually hone your skills while the wise master is still there.
So you've talked about a few, we'll call them landmines, that we need to be aware of. But let's kind of narrow down and look at what are some key things that as I think about my family farm business, I need to be aware of or mindful of, making sure that I'm not setting up traps for, you know, the success of the future of the farm. What are some of those things that I just need to be clear that if I'm on this path or I'm doing these things, it could end up with being a problem later on?
Well, do you remember the three little pigs and how the third one did it right? That pig put in one brick at a time with mortar in between to withstand the test of time. So our pitfalls come when we don't put our bricks in place. And then we build our house of sticks and we build our house of straw, and all of a sudden the wolf comes, and we know it happens in agriculture, and our farms and our businesses get blown down. So when it comes to family business, one of the biggest pitfalls is that they do not understand with family, more, not less, must be in writing. This is critical, Dean. Even if you're going to have labor in exchange for equipment, for heaven's sakes, put that thing in writing. If you're going to reward people for earned sweat equity, in other words, we're not paying them big bucks, but they're earning equity, the difference between the market value and what we're paying, that needs to transition every single year. These kinds of things must be in writing. And with that comes the pitfall of failing to use key advisors to make it happen. This means some things must be legal. Things must fit into the cash flow. You have to know your key ratios to make sure you're financially strong. And with that, another pitfall is we're building our business on shifting sand. I just sat with a family, and it real hard. I tried so hard to find solutions for them, and you know, usually I can get to a place where, okay, here's the next step. But I started their family business consultation by saying, "Thank you for inviting me to the funeral." And they all knew exactly what I was talking about, because that's the mindset that they came to the funeral. And they had built their entire equity business on rented ground, and no longer is the ground available to rent. But they had bought a lot of new equipment because we have more land to run. And we brought in two of the next generation, so now we have three households expecting to live off of this. And it was built on shifting sand. So if you're going to do that, make sure you know how to manage your risk and you have a plan B. Another big pitfall, Dean, is they avoid conflict. You know, heaven forbid we have to actually talk about things that may not be right, or things we may want to change, or things that are bugging us. Now, understand, some things just have to roll off your back. And believe me, during planting and harvest is not a time to be bringing up all this conflict. But I do find that the minute that it's over, everything breaks loose because you've been building up and building up. You have to have a way to deal with conflict at the mosquito bite level, and there are ways to do that. But it requires the leader modeling this and holding him or herself and others to account. Then the last thing I'll share is they fail to celebrate. You know, the successful businesses that I researched the last few years, they took the time to pause to applaud all they have done. And yet I had a farmer say to me, "Jolene, the work is never done. I mean, you get done with this and you got to do this." And I said, "That's a lie. The crops are in the bin. The work was done. The equipment was repaired. The work was done. The calves are on the ground. The work was done. The problem is you are like the hamster on the wheel, running round and round, getting burnt out, worn out, stressed out, wondering why the next generation doesn't want to jump on the wheel and also get burnt out, worn out, stressed out. What would happen if you just pause to applaud all that you have done?" The good, successful businesses know that they must find the good things in each other, the good things in their business, the good things in agriculture. And when they do that, then goodwill is restored and the family business is strong.
These have been some challenging times in agriculture the past few years. But you're so effective at really bringing perspective to the table. What's some words or perspective of encouragement that you want listeners to hear as we wind down?
Well, I'm always holding up that mirror to reality. You better take a look at where you are realistically at today in order to know the foundation of which you have to build, or if you might need to say goodbye and find something new to do. In these testing times, and oh, we have had them before, to ride the roller coaster is not easy. And yet, I was just contacted by a big financial organization. They wanted me to work with their senior leadership. How do we help this? How do they help these account managers go out and deal with farmers, knowing that foreclosure and bankruptcy might be a very realistic option out there? And I've said, you had people who went through this in the 80s. I know we lost a farm here. We've struggled along the way, and so have your people in the past. I think they owe your organization some of the skills that it took, some of the journey that they took, some of the grit that they had to help us right now today. So always reach out to those who have been around you. And then don't be afraid to talk about your concerns, your problems, and your celebrations. Get your mastermind groups. Get your peer groups. Turn to family. And if you see someone in your family who is having a change in behavior, for example, they no longer want to attend church, or they no longer are eating well, you know they're restless all night, you have to reach out for some professional help here, because suicides, depression, the mental health of what we're going through now is truly tested. There are people out there who will care. And if you just take a look at who helped you succeed to get where you are at today, those are the same people who will hold you up during today so you can still have a tomorrow.
Great message. Jolene, you've got a couple of really cool books out. Could you tell us a little bit about them and where we might be able to find them?
Yes. First of all, my website is just jolenebrown.com. But if you Google just Jolene Brown, J-O-L-E-N-E, you're either going to get me or a pole dancer. So keep looking for the speaker. I know that because I get Google alerts, and she's been busy. So the bottom line is my website is just jolenebrown.com. And there you're going to find, under the shopping section, I have the book, Sometimes It Takes More Than a 2x4, Tips from the Kitchen Tables. It is what I call a bathroom book. Take out all the other reading material. put this little book in there, which are tips and colored photographs. Put a bookmark in something that's really bugging you. And you know what? They're in the bathroom. They're going to pick it up and look at it, and they're going to say, what the heck is this all about? Well, that's a good way to start a conversation. So the first one is sometimes it takes more than a 2x4. And my last book is just a pure celebration. It's called Holy Crap, I Married a Farmer. And it's the joy-filled lessons for my sisters in agriculture. It's the lessons we learned when we have a spouse that dies, all the way to during planting and harvest and mealtime and raising kids and in-laws and outlaws. It is truly a thank you gift for the strong women in agriculture. But I had a fellow call me last Christmas and he said, I would like to give that gift to my wife for Christmas, but would you send it to my neighbor's house so she won't know she's getting it? I said, I can do that. They said, oh, but Jolene, if she reads it, am I going to be in trouble? I said, I hope so, because you're in the book. It's a pure celebration, Dean. And then I have a DVD series called The Top 10 Mistakes That Break Up a Family Business. For 3 hours, I take you to the kitchen tables of families just like yours that have asked me to help them fix, grow, or transition their business. And believe me, they taught me what works and what doesn't. And that's what's in the DVD series.
That's awesome. Joining me today has been writer, speaker, consultant, farmer, and advocate for agriculture, Jolene Brown. Jolene, thank you so much for joining us and sharing your insights today.
It's been a privilege. Thank you, Dean.
Thanks.